So I'm just going to tell you a bit about Secret and a few of the artworks in it. So Secret is the exhibition that's going to open up here next week, Friday, August 7th. So you should all come out for that. And in this exhibition, we're exploring things like cryptography, government leaks and surveillance, but also the why we love to tell secrets and keep secrets from each other. So kind of that range of approach to this topic of Secret. So what I thought I would do is just quickly introduce you to three works in the exhibition. I'm not going to go super in-depth, but just point to why they were maybe similarly problematic as the work we're looking at tonight. This is the least sort of legally worrying one, but it might set this up nicely in terms of what we think of as private or public or what we want to keep secret. I have a teleprompter down here. Please empty your pockets. And basically, it's a bit like an airport scanner. We're going to ask you to empty out your pockets, put them under the scanner, and then for the whole exhibition, we'll have a sort of video chain of what people have scanned through there. And I think that might be interesting in what do we do when someone really doesn't want to participate? Our pockets are this weird public-private space. We pretty much think we know that people can't, like, put their hands in there and just grab what's in there. But there's some vague amount of, you know, information of you from outside. So that'll be really fun. And I'm interested to see what people have in their pockets when they come through. Forgot Your Password is a piece that catalogs the, I think, 4.7 million leaked passwords from this 2012 leak of LinkedIn. And so you can come in and see if your password's in there. And if it is, you should probably change it. I think why this is interesting in terms of the legal issues is, you know, do we have any legal reason to not show this? You know, a lot of hackers will use large databases of known leaked passwords like this to do brute force attacks to try to break into different systems. Clearly, this is printed. It'd be a real pain to try to actually manually use this. But this kind of, and the artists themselves, as far as we know, didn't do this attack and scrape this data and leak it. But this is sort of, you know, you could say dangerous data that we're exhibiting. And finally, Loophole for All is a piece by an artist that was very interested in offshore tax havens. And what I thought was really funny is we have lots of different sponsors and people who help promote Science Gallery. And often artists will ask, can I show this piece with your sponsors? So that's a different kind of not an extra legal question, right? I mean, if you think about all the tech industry in Dublin, you know, part of the reason it's here is because of the tax incentives. How many people have heard of the double Irish Dutch sandwich? Okay, so that's about a third of the folks. So this kind of points at some of that. And in addition, this artist did do the hack and scrape this data, and we're showing it, and you can take one of these certificates with you and set up your own Cayman Islands offshore account and not pay taxes. So that'll be fun. So do come out for those three pieces. That's just to set the tone a bit. I'll just quickly talk about the curators, and then I'll show a couple of artworks from History 3 really quick, and then we'll be good to go. So these are our three curators. They have really different research interests and backgrounds, and it was nice working with them and hearing about their different perspectives on these issues. I'll just talk about, actually, Tad really quick. Tad worked on a precursor to Twitter, some of you may have heard of, called Text Mob, and this was designed for activists. In different activist movements so they can communicate with each other doing many-to-many SMS or text services. This also is really old-fashioned, but back in 2004, there wasn't a Twitter, and the idea here was to actually allow activists to avoid the police by using some of the same swarming tactics that Tad and his collaborator were seeing being studied by the military. So they made this piece of software. It was used by lots of people, and then they received a subpoena from the New York Police Department asking them to release the information about who was using their service. Luckily, I think the data was stored at MIT, and they were able to sort of fight that. But, you know, so one of our curators really had to deal with not what we often think of as an artistic space where there's a certain amount of safety granted to the artists, right? This was a sort of, in a way, a much more real space out in the streets and using servers that were getting subpoenas. And while he did have some of the backing of an institution like MIT, there were some real risks that people's sort of messages could be revealed that they didn't want to be revealed, and that he himself would have some kind of trouble. So that's just him. And then breaking news, our other curator, Julian Oliver, we're hoping to show one of his pieces, but it looks like a grenade, and apparently that's going to be really hard to ship. So just this afternoon, we're dealing with the legal implications of shipping something that looks like a grenade. So I've been involved with a lot of exhibitions in my life, and this is by far the most interesting and compelling in terms of the legal questions it raises. Pirate cinema, I saw Nicolas's work a few years ago for the first time live, this particular work at the AND Festival at FACT in Manchester in England. And it was awesome to see. I really enjoyed it. A very short synopsis of it is that it is a cinematic collage generated by peer-to-peer network activity. I saw it live, really liked it, was really happy that became part of the conversation for this exhibition, but right away I knew that Science Gallery is not an art space in England. There's actually different rules here in Ireland, and Science Gallery is not a sort of do-whatever-you-want art space. So right away I was like, what does it mean for copyright violation if we show this here? What does it mean about privacy violation in terms of us seeing what people are streaming, and can we make connections to their IPs? What about exhibiting pornography? You don't know what's going over these airwaves. There might be random things, and what are the laws about in Ireland? So all those questions kind of came up. So as Eoin mentioned, we thought the best way to you know, talk about this was to bring it to you guys. And I'll just leave you with three precedents. Back in 1979, Dara Birnbaum made a great video about Wonder Woman, or about gender in popular media, and it was 6 minutes of looping Wonder Woman transformations. And it was sort of cut whenever a man entered the screen, it went to white. And there's this great image of this guy sort of hiding behind the wall while she defends him. And so a question that I'll have for the panel is, if we showed this very old artwork in terms of contemporary art from 1979, which is in MoMA's collection, and we show this here in Ireland, are we going to have to pay the owners of Wonder Woman television show? Because in the US, I believe this is protected by fair use. But in Ireland, it could be quite a different question. So, I mean, this is old stuff we're talking about, it seems to me, but you know, I come from that fair use perspective. More recently, Christian Marclay's The Clock is a 24-hour video piece that acts as a clock. All 24 hours of the video either shows a clock or has someone talking about time, and it's all appropriated imagery from film and television. And Nicolas was just telling me in a conversation at some point that this has been a really problematic piece for a museum to acquire, and there's been challenges around it. So these things definitely happen with all kinds of institutions. And then lastly, just to go beyond the copyright, Kyle MacDonald had a really interesting piece and then sort of flame war online where he put some little code on Apple Store's Macs and took photos of people kind of without them knowing, and then sort of displayed those photos of people from Apple Store. And there's a great Wired article and sort of flame war about it. And so in terms of using people's or data, whether it's public or private, in an artwork, that might raise some of those questions. So that's what I'm going to bring to the table, and I hope the panel can tell me a bit more about what we should do. Thanks.
So our next panelist to talk about his work that has spurred this whole discussion is Nicolas Maigret.
Hi. So I will quickly introduce the work and what is behind it, the story, and maybe a bit of the concept. So the Pirate Cinema is a project I started like 4 years ago. And at the time I was working on showing the dynamics of the network and of the internet connections, exchanges, and activity. And at some point, I wanted to get back closer to the users and reveal or show the dynamic that are directly connected with the use and the traffic. So it brings me to the torrent activity and the peer-to-peer file sharing. So I wanted to make a piece that will actually just show what people are in the process of sharing, consuming, doing right now. So it brings us to a complex technical questions, but that's another story. Yes, so today it will look kind of an ancient trial where we will try to see if this project has a room, has a place here. But the lions hopefully will be symbolics, like yeah, the different major companies and the different issues it can raise. So the artwork is quite simple, actually. It's taking the shape of what we call a tracker. A tracker is basically a server where you will store a list selected list of files that you consider you want to make more available on the BitTorrent. So like Linux, you have a lot of servers in the world owned by university and so on that are storing Linux, so that it's really fast and quick to spread. So on our server, we are every day storing the 100 top most shared videos. And then if you want to download this video, there is a little chance that you will go through this server because this server is really well connected. So there is more chance that you will connect to this kind of server than a regular peer. And if you go through this server, then we are able to duplicate what is actually happening. So you have to know first that when you share and download stuff on the peer-to-peer, it's not a linear fashion. It's actually fragmented files. So you will get small chunks in a totally random fashion. And slowly the file will be complete, and you can afterward look at it. But we kind of grab these chunks as they are exchanged on the network, and bring it through a secure connection, so with a VPN, a secure VPN server, and then it's totally secure until the place, the venue where we show it. So it means that when we show it in gallery, for instance, there is no moment where we can actually see the IP of the gallery or the exhibition space. It can be an important point in the discussion. So as an exhibition, it looks like something between a home theater and a surveillance room, where you have many projectors and video projectors and many computers, and they are all looking for specific files and showing the chunks as they are arriving. So it's just an infinite collage of random chunks from the top 100 movies. And as a performance, it's a bit more narrative, perhaps. It has been structured as a kind of a personal history of file sharing, digital file sharing. So it's structured in chapters. And the first act is about what is supposed to be the first torrent, which is a pirated recipe book. The second part is about audiobooks, where you can hear a language from all over the world, and people in the process of downloading that. The third part is MP3, so it's basically only Metallica's album, as they are known as being the first big lawsuit against a file sharing company, Napster. Then you have the porn part, which is often displayed as an audio-only version. And lately you have the blockbuster, and blockbuster part is actually the biggest blockbuster of the day when we show the piece. And the last one is really close to the exhibition, as it's the top 100. So it's a big mashup of everything shared right now. Last few points. One is that in this process of interception of chunks, we are missing a lot of packets, and sometimes we miss some headers or some important parts in the video files. And it means that because of that, you will have artifacts and different glitches on the image. So they are very different than the original material. Also, an interesting part of the piece is that it kind of grab the geographical dynamics of exchanges. So you can see for each chunk where it come from and where it's going. And it really builds a kind of mental geography of this dynamics. And I just wanted to bring some arguments around the project. So what the pirate cinema probably is. So I think it's not that much about a collage, because it's not intentional. It's only or more an interception process. I kind of see it as a sociological group portrait, like what people are in the mood of consuming right now. And it's also like in experimental cinema, focused on the medium, so the materiality of image. And what does it mean to consume digital image today, which is not anymore a matter of material film. So experimental cinema today wouldn't be working with materiality of the film, but perhaps materiality of the data and these packets. And it kind of showed network dynamics. And on the other hand, it's not a physical media. So, I mean, what you just saw, the last chunk that you just saw is just disappearing. I mean, it never were there. It's just an interception device. So it's just appearing for the time of the chunk, and then it's gone. And it's because of this, it's absolutely not intentional. It's not for commercial purpose, and it's not a video remix. So I don't know if it can help for later discussion. All right, and for later I have some quotes from the business and from different monitoring companies, but maybe we can get back to that later.
Thanks, Nicolas. I should say that, you know, it's not the first time we've encountered kind of a legal question over some of the artworks we've had proposed at ScienceGuard, but it is kind of a growing trend that some of the most interesting artworks about laws and about potential legal conflicts do make us think, is it legal to show this? And one of the reasons we wanted to have this event is because if we're very cautious, we could have a potentially chilling effect that we're not featuring controversial artists or their artworks that are questioning and potentially be a catalyst for changing laws. On the other hand, we also don't want to get sued. We're part of a university, and you know, we have to be responsible in what we share and what we kind of give recognition to in the gallery as curators. So I should also say, actually, because the note about sponsors came up, we've had really interesting discussions with our sponsors when we have controversial things coming up, and I've never encountered any sponsors saying, you know, we have a problem with this. Some of them have said, maybe we can't be entirely associated with this, but it's really cool what you're doing and raises good questions. So before we go on, I want you all to look at this kind of motion, because this is it's effectively what we're going to debate. And I'd love to see a show of hands who agrees with this motion. You won't be getting in trouble or anything, so. Okay. Well, that's pretty split. Okay, maybe 60% of people. And anybody who disagrees, hands up. Okay. So there's a lot of people abstaining, it looks like. Who abstains and isn't sure? Okay, there's a few people who aren't voting, maybe about 20%. Well, what's interesting is we'll see who changed their view at the end. So to kick off, we're going to hear from Eoin Odell to tell us about potential conflicts with this point of view. Please put your hands together.
Hi, good evening. The key point here, I think, is the extent to which copyright both allows and prevents artistic endeavor. The first thing is that copyright allows artistic endeavor by incentivizing and rewarding it. So an artist gets rewarded for the artistic work. Now, the question might be the extent to which an artist does it out of the goodness of his or her heart versus the extent to which an artist expects or hopes to be rewarded. But copyright will reward an artist for the artistic work by allowing that artist to monetize it. And we, the consuming public, get the benefit of that. So copyright, by supporting artistic endeavor, supports both the artist and the community that gets the benefit of it. But on the other hand, if you as an artist want to appropriate, your appropriation can run into somebody else's copyright. You know, good artists copy, great artists steal, but either way, the copy or the steal is going to be an infringement of copyright, because somebody else has created it, that person has the copyright in it, you try and copy it, you're infringing the copyright. Unless unless A, you get permission. Now, most artists will just go ahead and produce the piece, and that's fine. But if they are infringing a copyright and they don't have permission, then that will be an infringement. One way of getting permission is saying, please, can I do it? Another way is if there is a generic license. And so universities have licenses to copy material in libraries, for example. We're not doing it because we're infringing copyright. We're doing it because the copyright licensing agency has given us permission to do it. And sometimes there might be a statutory exception. The statute that creates copyright and protects the artist and protects the artistic work and protects the copyright can also create a series of exceptions, which others can take advantage of and have the benefit of. And in Irish law, there's a small range of exceptions called fair dealing. Fair dealing for, I was going to say education, but there is in fact no education exception. It's fair dealing for the purposes of research or private study, and fair dealing for the purposes of instruction. Fair dealing, take the minimum amount necessary for the purpose of the exception. It's fair dealing, not fair use. Greg talked about fair use earlier. Fair use is an American doctrine that is considerably broader. It's a much wider exception. And everything that Nico wants to do that he described earlier would have no problem in the States because it would be fair use. It's not impacting on the market. It's not impacting on the exploitation of the work. It's not taking too much of the work. It's non-commercial. There is no problem. It would be fair use. But Irish law, European law, doesn't have that exception. So now, you're an artist like Nico. You create your work, you get the benefit of copyright to protect that work. In the process of creating that work, you're appropriating from elsewhere. That appropriation is an infringement. You go and ask, and you're told no. Or you don't go and ask. You think there might be an applicable license, like a Creative Commons license or a copyright licensing license, but there isn't. You hope there is a statutory exception. But here in the States, there's fair dealing. A lot of artistic development is based on fair dealing. Jeff Koons is a multimillionaire because of fair use. The Superwoman point that, Wonder Woman, the Wonder Woman example is fair use and therefore no problem in the States. But go north into Canada or go south into Mexico. Or east to Europe, where there is no fair use. There is the underlying copyright in the original materials. There is no statutory exception. And therefore, what is non-infringing in the States becomes infringing here. And that's Nico's problem. In different jurisdictions, the copyright laws are stricter or weaker. And in jurisdictions where the copyright laws are stricter, his work has the potential to run into copyright problems. And the example that he gave us, the description of the work that he gave us, has serious copyright problems because it's taking copyright material. Now, we all know that the torrents are a mixture of legitimately shared material and infringing material. And the infringement can be a copyright infringement, it can be a pornography, in which case it's illegal material, it can be an invasion of privacy, which is what secret is all about. Where it's an infringing material, simply reproducing the infringement is itself an additional secondary infringement. And what you think about it doesn't matter. You're simply reproducing the infringing material, you yourself are infringing. And so, if Nico puts some images, puts some audio, puts some work on the screen, on the speakers, that he's infringing that copyright too. And in the States, he might have the benefit of a fair use defense, but outside of the States, he doesn't have the benefit of the fair use defense. Should he, in a jurisdiction like Ireland, which doesn't have a fair use defense, nevertheless produce that art? And should a gallery like Science Gallery facilitate it and provide a gallery in which that art can be shown to the public? The motion says we should. I'm going to suggest to you instead that a responsible gallery will do something else. In most major jurisdictions in the world, at the moment, we're undergoing a process of copyright reform. We're undergoing a process of rebalancing copyright so that the restrictions on downstream innovation, the restrictions on downstream artistic endeavor, are removed so that it becomes easier for things like fair use to happen in Europe, in Canada, in Mexico, and in the Far East. But the only way that's going to happen is if the reform processes are lobbied by people who want to have the reform head in that direction, and then a government that is in the process of implementing those reforms continue to be lobbied. Copyright has become a business. Copyright has become a business model. There's a big difference between the starving artist in the garret or the people writing the next great song or the next great screenplay in their garages on the one hand, and the large corporations that actually own the copyrights in the materials that Nico wants to show on the other. Copyright is meant to incentivize the artist in the garret. It's meant to incentivize Nico. It's not meant, but it has become the basis of the business model for large, big content. And the reason why big content has appropriated copyright is very simple. They're big. They've got the money. They've got the ability to lobby, to encourage legislators in the direction of increasing copyright. Let me give you one example of this. Mickey Mouse. The copyright period is very long. In Ireland, it's life of the author plus 70 years. In the US, it's at least life of the author plus 90 years. And the reason why the copyright period keeps extending is that every time the copyright in Mickey Mouse is about to expire, Disney procure an extension of the copyright term in the US. Mickey Mouse was about to drop out of copyright 16 years ago, and guess what? Sonny Bono, a representative from California, which just happens to be where Disney is incorporated, brought a copyright term extension bill to the floor of Congress, and Disney lobbying got it passed. And it extended copyright by another 20 years. That was 16 years ago. That means Mickey Mouse is going to drop out of copyright in 4 years' time. We'll come back here in 5 years' time, and I am confident that copyright term will have extended in the US by then to keep Mickey Mouse within copyright. And that has nothing to do with copyright. Walt Disney is dead. He's not going to be incentivized to draw another Mickey Mouse cartoon by virtue of the extension of copyright. It is entirely due to the business model that copyright is. And it's the business model aspect of copyright that has this chilling effect on artistic endeavor. And how do we change it? Well, we can take advantage of the copyright reform processes that are as I said, are in the process of being undertaken all over the world at the moment. So, for example, the European Union is currently looking at extending the reach of licensing to make the kind of work to encourage copyright users to use copyright material. Licensing isn't the solution for Nico, though, because he won't know who to license the material from. And licensing won't necessarily be the solution because licensing is siloized into national licenses. So the European Union process isn't enough. What we need is a fair use doctrine implemented into Irish law, into European law, by analogy with the American position. And a fair use would plainly cover and defend what Nico wants to do. An Irish copyright reform process completed 18 months ago and recommended a fair use defense that would absolutely allow Science Gallery to show Nico's work, and is currently gathering electronic dust on an electronic server in the Department of Jobs, Enterprise and Innovation. What a responsible gallery would do is lobby the government to introduce the exception proposed in that report. It wouldn't break the law. It would make its efforts to change the law. I'm all for provocation. I'm all for controversy. But if you run into a roadblock, you don't take out the sledgehammer and try and break down the roadblock, you try and have it removed. And that's what a responsible gallery would do. It would lobby for the change in the law. Those changes are happening elsewhere. It's only a matter of time before it happens here. And that, I think, is what science galleries should do. I want to see Nico's work. I don't want to get Nico into trouble. I don't want to get Science Gallery into trouble. I think that a responsible gallery should have the law changed so it can show it. Copyright is not monolithic. It is not the property of big content. Copyright is to the benefit of everybody. And when it cuts down on that benefit, it needs to be changed. And I think that that's the real moral of Nico's story. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Eoin. Can we have the motion back on the screen? I'll now introduce maybe our sledgehammer-wielding opponent in the debate, Professor Linda Doyle.
Thank you very much, Eoin. So I've taken a slightly broader approach to discussing this, and I feel because Eoin said to us that we can just be extreme on each side, I don't have to be very logical or nuanced in it. But the one thing that I find really, really fantastic about artists is the way they're able to kind of move boundaries and draw fine lines between things. And it's a thing that really fascinates me. And I have three examples of works I want to talk about here and then just draw some very quick conclusions. So the first example, and I see one of my colleagues in the audience, and she'll believe that I never give a talk without mentioning this. So this is an artist I really love. I don't know whether people are familiar with this artwork. So in Brazil in the 70s, when you used to recycle Coca-Cola bottles, this particular artist used to take the bottles out of the system, print subversive messages on them. I suppose he saw Coca-Cola as a symbol of kind of US imperialism, and as Yankees go home was printed and put back into the system and refilled with Coke. And I love that idea, the idea that, you know, the artist's mind where you think, how do I get into the system and how do I twist the system around and how do I kind of get my messages out there? And I suppose when I'm thinking about the motion, I'm thinking, I suppose, more bluntly about legal and illegal. And I suppose you ask yourself the question, there's a very fine line. What's this artist doing here? They're pushing the boundaries. Is this legal? It seems kind of it is legal to me, but is it really? And I think it's a kind of a really, really interesting piece of work. So that's where I think there's a fine line. So the second example I want to give you is where I think there's a much finer line, and it's a very, very recent example, and I'm not sure whether people are familiar with it here, but this work by Emma Sulkovitz. So have people heard of this thing about the mattress? Anyone familiar with it? So this is a very interesting case. So Emma Sulkovitz was an undergraduate in Columbia University. She, and I'm using the word allegedly because it was never proven one way or the other, raped by one of her classmates in her early years there. And it went through an internal process within the university, and the person was deemed not responsible or innocent of the accusation. And in response to that, she decided to create an art piece where she would carry the mattress on which she was raped around for the remainder of her time in the university. So she not alone did this, this was actually her final, her performance piece for her, the work of art that she submitted as an artist. And the university itself, they instructed, for example, there's shuttle buses that go around the university, and they actually instructed people driving the shuttle buses that she should actually be allowed to take the mattress on board with her. And of course, this has caused a huge, enormous amount of debate. I mean, it got enormous coverage. She's on the front of the New York magazine there. And essentially, the guy involved felt very, very victimized. And now there's a court case where he is taking a reverse gender discrimination case against Columbia University on the basis that if he was a man behaving like that to a woman, that that would be seen as bullying. So it's a very, very nuanced, complex case, but very, very interesting. And I think kind of goes to the heart of kind of, I suppose, activist art, and I think one really worth considering. So that's the second thing I want to comment on. And then I think the third thing I want to comment on, and it's about there being no lines at all where it's obvious that something is completely and utterly illegal. And I'm just using a very, very simple example here. I come from a radio and wireless background and the pirate radio station. So this is an old picture of Radio Caroline. There's probably loads of people here who don't know what that is, and people my age who do. But, you know, there was a time when there was very, very little, I suppose, choice and an ability to hear different things and different music. And the pirate radio stations, you know, had these glory days, and some of them actually operated off, you know, on boats in the sea, off land, transmitting signals. And I think one of the very interesting things, and it kind of goes back to a lot what Eoin was saying in terms of like how you protest and how you get the laws to change. And I understand where you're coming from, Eoin, in terms of the responsibility of an organisation. But in this case, I think you know, absolute illegal action has changed the way that we get to listen to a wider variety of radio stations, for the better or the worse. People might think I can't bear all the stations that exist now, and they're all the same. But nonetheless, it's a very, I suppose, specific illegal act that has led to change, and has also led to a deeper understanding of what it means to occupy airwaves. And even if you look back at early pirate radio station, and you look now at things like Wi-Fi, which is in a free band, the ISM band, it's kind of part of that kind of culture that's grown about a certain set of rights that we can actually occupy certain frequency bands and be allowed to communicate on them. And I think another really interesting point here is I really, really like Nicolas's work. It's really, really interesting, but you can actually show that and not actually interrupt or disrupt beyond a certain space. And the very interesting thing about radio waves is that they're a physical thing that can actually wreck and wreak havoc with other communication systems around them. And we could, in principle, operate a system in this gallery on mobile phone radio frequencies, for example, and bring down a radio network around us. And, you know, so I think it's really, really interesting as well when you talk about, you know, acts and illegal acts and the lines that you're drawing and how far you can go and what, I suppose, what's the radius of disturbance that's going to be caused about them. And I think it's something that's kind of worth thinking about in those. So I give those three examples. They're very, very different. And I now kind of, I suppose, want to draw, you know, this is only a 5-minute thing. I want to draw a conclusion, I suppose, from each of those. So I suppose my first conclusion when I think of the Morales work and the Coca-Cola bottles is that I think we're living in a land where we're quite devoid of intellectual debate on a political scene. If you look at our political representatives, if you even look at the United States and you see that someone like Donald Trump is kind of the top of the poll in the GOP candidates at the moment, and you go, where are we? I think that to a certain extent, I mean, our only hope is for that nuanced debate to come from some kind of illegal infringing acts from an artistic space. I suppose that's my first comment. My second comment is, if you look at what happened in Ireland in the latter few weeks, where somebody who you know, admitted to raping a woman got a 7-year suspended sentence and didn't serve one day in prison. And you know, you had a lot of outrage about that. But it was kind of, actually, what do I take that back? There wasn't a lot of outrage about that. There was some mutterings in the press. You then ask yourself, do the kinds of acts that Emma Sokovitz does, whether she was right or wrong, we need things like that, because certainly we're not making any progress or getting anywhere or changing anything or actually saying anything beyond kind of like the usual cautious remarks that are in the newspapers. That's the second thing I'd say. And the third thing I'd say is that, yes, you can get change by responsibly arguing, but sometimes I think you have to take the sledgehammer. And the pirate radio station, for me, is a symbol of that sledgehammer, where you kind of actually actively do something, and you go out and you occupy a space, a virtual space of airwaves, and you cause change. And I think that's really essential. And I suppose I'll end with a thing in terms of a responsible institution. So I work in Trinity. I love working here, and I have a very privileged job. But I also, this institution also drives me completely crazy. And when I stand back and I think, the thing that has most outraged my colleagues in the last 10 years through all the crises that we have is when we changed the color blue on the logo. And we had enormous amounts of outcry. town hall meetings with people reporting things in the press. And I think that is an absolute crying shame that this university, very, very conservative university, and loads of universities in Ireland and other institutions have nothing better to say. You know, we, I think, have backed away hugely from making any strong statements on any topic. And I, you know, I feel this very, very passionately, and I suppose I'm complicit in that by working here. And I think our only hope is to have places like the Science Gallery, to have artists who challenge these ideas, to actually come in and maybe shake us out of our complacency. I certainly see in my own work, which is very technical, that it's a lot of the times the artists I depend on who challenge the power laws, who challenge the status quo, who don't believe that design is neutral and can understand the power relationships that we are creating, that is hugely important. So I certainly hope that Science Gallery is responsible enough to embrace illegal acts that are much more illegal than what Nicolas is presenting here. So you know what side of the motion I'm on. Thank you.
Thank you, Linda. Well, I'll ask all the panelists to come back on stage, actually, to join us for a quick discussion. Then we'll open up to questions to you guys. So if you guys just want to come up and have a seat. I think one thing that came up there was we're almost debating, in a way, two different questions.
Yeah.
Which is very good. But which is the question, which I'll throw back to you, which is the question we should be asking? Should we be asking whether we should do this or whether we can do this? Because there's potentially, we could all agree that we can't, but we should.
Could I?
Well, Eoin pointed out to me that the examples I gave weren't illegal. So I think in one sense, I think by pointing out that to me, I think there are ways to do things that you can get around it. But I think you should do them anyway.
Since she quoted me, I'm going to agree with her. The most interesting one is whether Radio Caroline was illegal. And it wasn't, because the whole point about the pirate radio ship is that it sailed outside the three-mile limit, as it was at the time, and broadcast from international waters. So it wasn't within the jurisdiction to which it was broadcasting. So there are all sorts of things you can do to push the limits all the way.
And so off-site performance of pirate radio or cinema is what you're saying we should do.
You might very well think that. I could possibly comment. But all three of the examples are examples where the legalities were pushed to the very limits. But I don't think in any of those three cases there was actually anything illegal.
The Radio Caroline was just the random picture I used, but there's plenty of examples of pirate radio stations in
Sunshine,
Ireland.
For example,
tons
in
of
Dublin,
them,
yeah.
And in fact, actually, you know, the regulators will come in and like hack open the places and take away the equipment. And so I take your point. That's a bad example, but yeah, in general, radio stations and...
Okay.
If I can add something, does it work?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Radio Caroline seems to be a quite a fair good example for me, because as I explained with the VPN, the fact that the last part of the transmission is totally secured and invisible to a surveillance authority, I think there is a fair parallel we can do with the pirate radio, where actually just the position of the boat is outside the legal frame, but actually the place where you can actually listen to that is a place where it's illegal, right? Because you can listen to this radio on the land where it's illegal. So that's totally the fine line where we've been working on for the installation version, where the gallery where we exhibit the work can never be catched by surveillance systems, but still the work is on display.
But is that you mean so somebody can't tell that you're doing it, but obviously they can tell because they're there and see it?
You can't have any trace of what happened, because even if you run a surveillance device, you would see only encryption. Mm-hmm. Encryption data going through the internet, and that's it.
If we ran it now, that surveillance device would be able to record the fact that it was happening here.
Yeah.
There is a difference between the Radio Caroline situation and your installation in this way. The listening to the Radio Caroline radio broadcast was not illegal, whereas downloading illegal content is illegal. So the gallery you're committing the copyright infringement in what you do, and the gallery is also committing a copyright infringement by downloading and allowing it to happen. So the gallery isn't like somebody listening to radio, because listening to the radio isn't illegal, but downloading a copyright infringing material is illegal, and that's part of the problem for the gallery. It's not like putting up a radio and broadcasting Radio Caroline. It's a secondary copyright infringer in its own right.
And how big a problem is that? I mean, what is the actual likelihood that we're going to face consequences?
Well, the more you put your head above...
I want to know practically.
She's trying to get free advice.
Yeah, I understand that, yeah. Well, hold on, though. Let me start calculating the...
You're on the clock.
Okay, it's about 3.5% chance of liability.
Okay.
The short answer is that there is no good reason for a copyright owner to come after Nico to try and prevent him from doing what he's doing. But there's a difference between the absence of a good reason why a copyright owner might not want to do it and irresponsible gallery, because that's the word I'm picking on all the time, deciding whether or not it can or it should. To go to your question, can it versus should it, as a matter of copyright law, you can't. As a matter of risk, should you? As a matter of artistic freedom, should you? As a matter of academic freedom, should you? Unfortunately, there are no academic freedom or artistic freedom exceptions built into the Irish copyright legislation or the European copyright acquis. The only safety valve for those kinds of things is the American fair use, and we don't have it here. Europe doesn't have it yet either. In America, you can. In Ireland, you can't.
Can I bring up something about the spirit in a letter of locks? This is really interesting, the U.S. case. On the one hand, you're saying the fair use as opposed to fair dealings, right? Mm-hmm. Allows for, in some ways, more artistic expression. But one of the things you said that I was really struck by, copyright, I don't know the exact phrasing, it was really funny phrasing. Copyright is what allows artists to make money. But
what I said was copyright incentivizes and rewards.
Well, you said incentivizes, right? Yeah. Rewards. That was one. Yeah. But clearly, as contemporary artists, we never make money. We're always broke. Right. And well, so whether that's good or bad is not the point. What's quite interesting is, on the one hand, the U.S. has more room for artistic license legally, but the companies that are doing the most suing, right, and the big copyright holders are also in the U.S. So we're saying MGM. So there's a huge discrepancy between the spirit of the law and the letter of the law between these two sort of big economies and political cultures, right? The EU and the U.S. The U.S. you basically do whatever you want as long as it's like artistic license. I mean, that's what I've seen, without much risk. But it's also the place where all the sort of copyright holders are pursuing the hardest.
Yeah.
And here we see much more constrained in this space in terms of not having fair use, but we would be less worried about probably big EU copyright holders coming after us. We'd be much more worried about the MGMs and the...
Oh, no, I'd be worried about Bertelsmann, and I'd be worried about Reed Elsevier as well.
But no one's downloading their stuff. I mean, rather, that's what's like really interesting. Like, most of the content you're downloading is, in terms of the top 100 seeds, often it's Hollywood blockbusters, or maybe you could talk about that. Yeah, what is it? Is it mostly American content, or is it?
If we talk about the top 100, it's mainly American content. Like 90% is based on TV shows and blockbusters, perhaps a few video clips, but that's it. I mean, most of the traffic is just that.
What about copies of sport of local recent sporting events?
There are a few in the top 100. You from time to time you can have like big wrestling games and stuff like that, or like a sports show, but once a year when it's really like
a final or something.
Yeah, that's it.
Nicolas, have you ever come across this before? Do we strike you as just extremely cautious in even considering this? And do most places that you've screened this say, go ahead, you know?
So actually, I really think that in a lot of country, this gray zone where art can happen is maybe more tolerated. I just think that the issue actually exists everywhere, but depending on the history of every country, there is a different relation to this gray zone of where art can happen, even if it's not exactly legal. So I think if we were too much concerned about that, we will have missed a lot of artworks in the last 100 century, you know, like 100 years. I mean, since the Dada artists were doing only collage, you know, from existing stuff, and citation work have been a big part of art production since like early 20th century. Okay. So I think it's not much different, and even it's maybe lighter because there is nothing fixed on media. You know, you cannot resell anything. Mm-hmm.
But I don't really see concern. You've shown this piece quite a bit.
Yeah.
And it's often in sort of contemporary art spaces. Have you shown it, and which might exist slightly differently than something like that's affiliated within a university. Have you shown it at other universities? It seems to me like the AND Festival, where I saw the piece, in fact, may have been slightly less risk averse. Right, it's an art space as expected. Whereas because this is associated with a university, there's somehow a different barrier, or? I mean, has any other institution you've worked with brought up this question up in a, I don't know if we can.
Maybe there is a bit, some of the point is the fact that it's part of an institution. Mm-hmm. Also the fact that it's in Ireland, and it seems like the legal frame is a bit different, perhaps. But I'm pretty sure that just the fact of talking about it make it even more maybe complicated. Mm-hmm. Because if we just had this show right now, preventing recording devices, it will just be over and done, you know.
And we all deny we ever saw it. Could I just pick up on that? This idea of tolerance around copyright infringement. We as a society are in fact tolerant of a lot of small-scale copyright infringement. Looking at the sea of faces, if I talked about burning CDs and transferring your CD onto an MP3 player, a lot of you will know what I'm talking about. This is sort of pre-streaming. That's a copyright infringement. Before 2000, making a video of what was happening on the television was a copyright infringement. But we widespread video recorders before 2000. They didn't just sort of appear before then. There's widespread format shifting on our media of our favorite music and our favorite movies and so forth. Any user-generated content that's put up on YouTube that takes other music or other movies or, you know, takes samples or collages or whatever, these are all copyright infringements. But as a society, we have come to the conclusion that this shouldn't count. And mostly at that small scale, the music and movie industries, the big content, don't have an issue with it. Nico is in exactly that space, in the space of things that are not having any commercial impact in a small scale, that have a widespread social value, that I suspect that the music and movie industries won't have a problem with.
Can I just point out an example where we had the opposite experience, and it was here, and it was a few years ago during an Open Here festival that Rachel O'Dwyer had curated, and it was a group of artists who'd taken aerial footage of Dublin with the drone. It was when the drone cameras were first out. And it was mainly showing, we'll say, a lot of the wasteland kind of, that came out over the kind of, the downturn in the economy and the kind of the construction that was left unfinished. But it also flew over Mountjoy prison, and it also flew over Orsanukthrone, where the president lives. And the guards actually came in here and made them take those sections of the footage out. Now, I was really surprised for exactly the same reasons that A, they knew it existed, B, turned up, and in fact, the film had to run for the remainder of its time in the Science Gallery with those bits blotted out. And that was despite the fact that you can look at Mountjoy from Google. You can look at Google Maps and you can look at satellite images and you can see things just as clearly, or you can look at anything else. So I was quite surprised they took some action. Now,
there is a lot of restrictions.
They were very polite when they showed up.
So that was the thing. They were polite, but they still said you can't do it. Yeah. And you didn't do it. That was the point, that the gallery and the artist chose to blank those images.
Well, they did the action. I mean, that's actually kind of funny, is the footage is actually really boring. And so in some ways, right, the action was done. That's what's interesting. for the provocation. Yeah. And then showing the footage is not, well, whatever. Yeah. It's more the fact, wow, this is actually contested space.
Yeah.
And actually the fact that it was blanked out, and I don't know how it was shown, if it said, like, don't look at this. And
it was kind of, it was made fuzzy and it said, removed a card.
I mean, in some ways it's much more interesting because we've all seen drone footage now, so it's been like, well, whatever.
Yeah, you know, but it was like, at the time when it was kind of a new experience of seeing that kind of footage. And you are right. I don't know who was involved in taking the decision, but the decision was the guards turned up and we complied with them.
Well, I would say two things. First, there is a sort of a national security executive issue here that, you know, Ars Nuchtheruin and our biggest prison are the sorts of things where the security of the state is in fact impacted. And secondly, drones, every drone that is sold now is sold with GPS maps and information about the restricted airspace. So you would not have been able to fly a modern drone over those spaces because all of the information that they have prevents them from flying into restricted spaces. So it was interesting that it happened sort of early in the life cycle of drones.
I think on a general point, though, I think it is, I do agree with you in principle that it's very important to work within the system as well. And I think one thing that happens with a lot of artworks is that I think, I find anyway, that artists naturally have a way of trying to understand how you actually, you know, infiltrate the system or even kind of find those gray spaces. And I think that's really, really useful. So even in cases where, for example, they still maintain legality but have pushed it to the limits, or where they're kind of touching on the edge of it and they're kind of bringing the attention to it to us. I think that's a start of kind of drawing attention to the fact, because I do feel it's harder and harder. We're so kind of, I suppose, I think we're so much more part of the system these days, and how we're all so interconnected, from a communications perspective and everything, that it can be harder to, it's virtually impossible to escape from it. So I think everything you have to do is within it. But I think more than, I think you find better ideas and more ways of kind of, I suppose, finding ways to intervene by looking at works of art these days than a lot of the time you do through, I suppose, more mainstream political debate. And that's what kind of attracts me to some of these things, if you can take them beyond. So to a certain extent, I think it's pointless. I don't want to, you know, just have something in the science gallery because it's controversial and then might get a bit of publicity and it might be just in a random newspaper. But if it can really set something in motion that kind of has a more permanent effect, and I think that's hard. I think a lot of the artistic ideas are these really great seeds, and it's just how could you actually take them further and push them further? Sorry, I'm rambling.
No, not at all. I think it's a good place to leave it for now. I think we don't have a full consensus on it, but I won't ask everybody to vote again, but could I see a show of hands of anybody who changed their mind about the sort of the motion of the evening, who was on one side but now on the other? Okay. A couple. Okay, so people are pretty set in what they think. Right. Okay. Strong convictions in the crowd. Well, listen, we have some refreshments. But before we head out to that, I just want to thank our wonderful panelists, Zack, Nicolas, Eoin, and Linda. So let's give them a warm round of applause.